Witam Państwa w kolejnej debacie Nowej Konfederacji. Dzisiejsza dyskusja poświęcona jest polskiej premierze wydawanej przez wydawnictwo Nowej Konfederacji oraz wydawnictwo Universitas, książki profesora Johna Mersheimera z Uniwersytetu w Chicago, książki pod tytułem Wielkie Złudzenie, Liberalne Marzenia, a Rzeczywistość Międzynarodowa. Jest to absolutnie pozycja obowiązkowa dla wszystkich osób zainteresowanych sprawami międzynarodowymi i geopolityką. Książkę tę kupicie m.in. w księgarni Nowej Konfederacji. Link do niej znajdziecie w opisie poniżej filmu oraz teraz w prawym górnym rogu ekranu. Debata odbyła się oczywiście z udziałem jej autora, profesora Mersheimera, dlatego też została przeprowadzona w języku angielskim. Napisy do tejże debaty znajdziecie w prawym dolnym rogu ekranu, dokładnie w nawigacji YouTube'a. Gorąco zachęcam do wykorzystania tychże napisów. Życzę udanej dyskusji.
Welcome to the debate. It's a great honor to host such renowned and astounding scholars. I have to say that I had a bit of a problem. Who should I introduce first? And I actually called, given the fact that there is a former Minister of Foreign Affairs taking part, I called the ex-head of the diplomatic protocol of the Polish MFA. Then I asked him, who should I introduce first? And he told me, well, you know, I could offer you a theory, but then others would offer you a different theory. So I'm going to do it in the alphabetical order, if that's all right. So I would like to welcome Małgorzata Bonikowska, chairman of the Center of International Relations, lecturer at the Warsaw University, and one of the best experts on EU affairs. I do not understand EU affairs, and whenever I need advice, I call Małgorzata Bonikowska. We also have Minister Jacek Czaputowicz, former Minister of Foreign Affairs between 2018 and 2020, a political scientist, and which has to be added, a member of the opposition during the communist era, one of those who really stood up, had the courage to stand up to the communist authorities. Professor Czaputowicz has been actually detained for more than 1.5 year. We also do have Professor John Mersheimer, a world-renowned political scientist, professor at the University of Chicago, and one of the leading, or I should rather say, a leading realist, representative of the realist school of thought. And last but not least, our host, Bartłomiej Radziejewski, founder and chairman of Nowa Konfederacja, one of the few, or should I say, sadly, few places where a real intellectual debate is going on. Bartek is a person that I agree and disagree, and it's always a pleasure to both agree and disagree. We more often agree, I have to say.
Now, thank you very much, Vito. It's a great honor.
I did watch one of Professor Mersheimer's lectures on YouTube, and a former student of professor introducing him said he learned two things, two basic rules. First, keep it simple, or the phrase was actually keep it simple, stupid. And the second, engage with the idea, don't attack the person. Now, the second part is obvious and granted, given who takes part in today's debate. I would kindly ask you to stick to the first part too. And I would also kindly ask you to stick to my rule, and that is keep it short, because we otherwise might run into like a 10-hour debate. I suggest we would divide our debate into two parts. The first one, which will start immediately, will be Professor Mersheimer giving us a sort of an executive summary of his book, The Great Delusion, and then we would have a debate about it. And later, I would ask you a few questions, which I took the liberty to prepare. So before I give the floor to Professor Mearsheimer, just one request, Professor. I did on purpose quote the gentleman who was the head of the Polish protocol, diplomatic protocol, him saying that he could offer a theory, but others could offer a different theory. Now, you're surely a person who enlightens me and enlightens many other people, who opens minds and offers explanations to a very complicated world. But I would also ask you if you could explain, is a theory of international relations something of a grand theory which explains everything, or should we accept as a rule that every theory has its flaws? Every theory is meant to be discussed, is meant to get into conflict with other theories. So the floor is yours.
Yeah, I'll start by just saying I'm thrilled to be here. I greatly appreciate the invitation. I appreciate the fact that everybody has come out to debate the issues on the table with me. And I greatly appreciate publishers publishing my book in Polish. Probably my most famous book, The Tragedy of Great Power Politics, has also been published in Polish. That thrills me no end. And I think the covers on both of those books are the best two covers of any books I have had published. Let me just say a word or two about theory before I talk about the book. I believe that we live in an incredibly complicated world, and theories are simplifications of reality. A theory is designed to help us understand that complicated world. And when you put together or you build a theory, you leave certain factors on the cutting room floor. These are factors that you don't think are that important. And you focus on a handful of factors, you know, two or three factors that you think are the most important factors for explaining, let's say, great power politics. But what occasionally happens is that those factors that you leave on the cutting room floor are very important in a specific case, and your theory is proved wrong. This tells you that no theory can be right all of the time. My intuition, and it's just my intuition, is that the best theories are right 75% of the time. That means they're wrong 25% of the time. Peter Katzenstein, who teaches at Cornell University, once said to me he thought the best theories were right only 50% of the time. And again, this is because theories are simplifications of a complicated reality, and they're not always going to capture that reality. Now, it's also important to understand that we live in a world where there are competing theories. I'm a realist, and in the American context, there are different kinds of realists. And with regard to how the United States should deal with China today, there are fundamental differences between me on one hand and most of my realist friends on the other hand. Then there are the liberals, and here we're talking about liberal foreign policy, liberal IR theorists, people like Robert Cohen, people like John Eikenberry. They have a fundamentally different view of international politics than a realist like me has. So you have these competing theories, and it's very important to understand you're always going to have competing theories, and it's a healthy thing to have competing theories. That's point one. And point two, those theories don't always work. They sometimes fail because of those factors that are on the cutting room floor that jump up and confound your theory. So that's my basic view on the role of theory. Now, that is an excellent segue into what I wanted to say about my book. I had two goals when I wrote the book. The first was I was very interested in the relationship between realism, nationalism, and liberalism. These three isms are of enormous importance for understanding the world. And nobody had ever written an article or a book talking about how realism, liberalism, and nationalism interact with each other, especially in the realm of international politics. And that was one of my goals in writing the book. My second goal, which was related, as it turned out, was to explain why American foreign policy during the so-called unipolar moment was a disaster. If you go back to 1990, when the Cold War ended, the United States was in a wonderful position. We had just won the Cold War, the Soviet Union was defeated, and shortly thereafter, the Soviet Union collapsed. Francis Fukuyama wrote The End of History, which basically said, America won, the world is our oyster. It's smooth sailing from here on out. If you look at the situation the United States is in today, especially in the realm of foreign policy, it's quite clear that something has gone badly wrong. And what I wanted to do in The Great Delusion was explain what went wrong. And I wanted to use my views on liberalism, nationalism, and realism to explain what went wrong. Now, what exactly is going on here? The first point I want to leave the audience with and my interlocutors with is that it's important to understand that before 1989, we lived in a bipolar world. For those of us who are old enough to remember the Cold War, we grew up in a bipolar world. In 1989, certainly 1991, when the Soviet Union collapses, we went from bipolarity to unipolarity. In 2017, when President Trump entered the White House, the United States was in the midst of transitioning from a unipolar world to a multipolar world. So, for someone like me, who was born 74 years ago today, I lived first in bipolarity. So I was born into a bipolar world. We went to unipolarity, and now we're going to multipolarity. This structural set of changes is of enormous importance. Now, what exactly do I mean? I believe that in a bipolar world or a multipolar world where there are more than one great power, two in a bipolar world, today we have three great powers, great power politics and realism are alive and well. In a unipolar world, by definition, you cannot have great power politics because there is only one great power in the system. So in a unipolar world, realism is of little importance to the unipole, i.e. the United States. The United States did not have to engage in great power competition between 1989 and 2017. Because there was no other great power in the system. That world has gone away. We're in a new world today. The United States and China, the United States and Russia. This is great power politics. So realism is back on the table. During the unipolar moment, the United States was free to pursue an ideological foreign policy. Realism was off the table, and it pursued a policy called liberal hegemony. It's a thoroughly liberal foreign policy. The United States normally behaves in realist fashion. It disguises its behavior with liberal rhetoric. It talks like a liberal country and acts like a realist country almost all of the time. That was not true in the unipolar moment. It's the only time in American history that we were free to pursue a highly ideological foreign policy. And the policy we pursued was called liberal hegemony. And that policy was a colossal failure. Now, what exactly is liberal hegemony? Liberal hegemony is designed to make the world look like the United States. It's designed to remake the world in America's image. And there are basically three things that the Americans set out to do. First of all, help make every country on the planet a liberal democracy like the United States. And that was the most important goal. Spreading liberal democracy all over the planet. The second goal was to integrate countries all over the planet, and here we're talking especially about Russia and China, into the liberal economic order that the Americans had played the key role in creating during the Cold War. So we wanted to integrate the Russians and the Chinese and every other country on the planet into that liberal economic order. The third goal was to integrate all of those countries into the international institutions that the United States had helped create during the Cold War. Institutions like the World Bank, the IMF, GATT, which eventually becomes the World Trade Organization. Okay? So this is the goal. Number one, spread democracy. Number two, integrate countries into the liberal economic order. And number three, integrate them into international institutions. Now, let me give you an example of this strategy at play. After 1990, in Europe, the United States decided to spread NATO eastward, to spread the European Union eastward, and to spread color revolutions all over Eastern Europe. This was not a policy of realpolitik. This was not a policy that was designed to contain first the Soviet Union and later Russia. It is very important to understand that. There is no evidence that we saw Russia as a future threat, and we were expanding NATO eastward to prevent the resurrection of the Soviet Union or a greater Russia, and so forth and so on. No, this was liberal hegemony at play. And if you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Think about the color revolutions. The color revolutions were designed to spread democracy in places like Ukraine, the Orange Revolution, Georgia, the Rose Revolution. And indeed, we were interested in spreading a color revolution into Russia. We were interested in regime change in Russia. Spreading democracy. What about moving NATO and moving the EU eastward and bringing in new members? These two organizations are international institutions. The EU, one of the most successful international institutions in world history. NATO, another one of the most successful institutions in world history. We were working hard to integrate countries in Eastern Europe into those institutions. And furthermore, we were interested in getting all of those countries hooked on capitalism because we believed that would help facilitate peace. We were trying, we meaning the Americans, to create a zone of peace, right? A liberal world in Eastern Europe that would eventually include Russia, because we believe that this would lead to a peaceful world. We did the same thing in the Middle East. What was the Bush Doctrine all about? The Bush Doctrine was all about spreading liberal democracy to the Middle East. The United States had a terrorism problem. It had a nuclear proliferation problem. And it had rogue states in the Middle East that it had to deal with. What is the best way to deal with a proliferation problem, a rogue state problem, and a terrorism problem? The answer is very simple. Make every country in the region look like the United States. You all know that the Americans think they're the good guys. And if everybody looks like us, we live happily ever after. How could it be otherwise? And furthermore, if everybody gets hooked on capitalism, we're all getting richer and richer and richer. Why would we start a war? Why would we cause trouble? Why would we need nuclear weapons? The answer is we wouldn't. So the idea was to remake the world in America's image. That's what NATO expansion, EU expansion, and the color revolutions were all about. I know people in Poland don't think about it that way because they think about everything in terms of the Russian threat. I understand that. But that's not the way the Americans were thinking. The Americans were not thinking in terms of realpolitik. The United States is a fundamentally liberal country. And when it was finally free to pursue a liberal foreign policy, you got liberal hegemony. And it has been a disaster. And it has been a disaster for two very simple reasons: nationalism and realism. Just about a few words about nationalism, a few words about realism, and then I'll stop. The idea that the United States can interfere in the politics of other countries and tell them what their politics should look like is a prescription for disaster. This is the cause of the forever wars in the Middle East. The United States thought that it could go in, topple the regimes in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Libya, and the end result is we could do the social engineering that was necessary to turn those countries into liberal democracies. It did not work. It did not work. Nationalism is all about sovereignty. It's all about self-determination. Poland does not like the European Union. Poland does not like other countries telling it how to run its domestic politics. Poles want to run their own domestic politics. Americans want to run their own domestic politics. They have their own cultures. They have their own ways of doing business. The United States thought that didn't matter. The United States thought that it could go into countries, could do social engineering, easily turn those countries into liberal democracies, and we'd live happily ever after. Instead, we ended up in the forever wars. That's the nationalism kicking back against liberalism as a foreign policy. Then there's the realism, and this is the cause of the Ukraine problem today. It is, in my opinion, foolish in the extreme to think that you could take NATO, an alliance that had been a mortal enemy of the Soviet Union, and you could push it up to Russia's borders, and that the Russians would just stand there and do nothing. The Russians, including Gorbachev, made it clear from the beginning that for realist reasons, NATO expansion coupled with EU expansion coupled with the color revolutions was unacceptable to them. You may not like that. Americans may not like that. But the realists, the Russians, were acting like good old-fashioned realists. And the end result is that our policy in Eastern Europe blew up in our face. And we now have terrible relations with the Russians. And we're worried about a possible war over Ukraine. So if you look at what America's position in the world looked like at the beginning of the unipolar moment in 1990, and you look at where we are today, you see that things have gone badly wrong. And the main cause of all of this trouble was the adoption of a liberal foreign policy, what I call and others call liberal hegemony, and forgetting the power of nationalism and forgetting the power of realist logic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. I actually made some notes and I have questions, but those will come later. I would like to ask Professor Czaputowicz. I did mention in the introduction that Professor Czaputowicz is a courageous person who spent, as I understand, more than 1.5 years in communist detention and fought for what, as I understand, you're to a large extent criticizing. Do you believe, Minister, that the U.S. foreign policy was a disaster or a colossal failure? Because these were the two phrases used by Professor Mersheimer.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me to take part in this debate. Let me start by saying that I follow works by Professor Mersheimer, starting with Back to the Future, which was an excellent piece on the end of the Cold War and challenges we faced then, and also the false promise of international institutions, criticisms of liberalism. So I'm sure it's visible that he's very consistent with his views and criticisms of liberalism. However, I don't think we can simply say that or qualify American foreign policy as liberal in all these times. I think that, yes, as you also, Professor, wrote in your book, states speak liberal, but they act as realists. And it was something like that, because when you look at the problem US face today, which is powerful China, the engagement with China was made not because the Americans, in my opinion, wanted to change the Chinese system, but simply they wanted to pursue economic gains. American companies wanted to make profit, and it was very good business for them. Therefore, I think often there is a realist goal having this also, so to say, narrative, liberal narratives. And it is also with other countries like that. So this is my first point. So I don't think that the American policy was wrong, and I don't want to comment on particular steps. Let me also comment on Ukraine to what Professor just said, in reference to two terms, crucial one in his book, nationalism and realism. When we agree that nationalism is very important for countries and sovereignty is very important for countries, we should also recognize that it is important for Ukraine. Okay, so Ukraine has the right to pursue policy which strengthens its sovereignty. And the problem is how the world should react. I agree that we should, and the US should, refrain from interfering to the affairs of other countries. You mentioned a lot of examples with color revolutions. But I would also argue that it is a specific liberal feature. There were many examples and very, very many realist motives for this intervention. So, when we talk about NATO enlargement and American policy in Central and Eastern Europe, we could also argue that it was realistic policy because it strengthens its sense of security, influence, gives power, gives prestige. So I am very careful in criticizing the American policy, particularly using these categories. Let me also comment on one thing visible in your book and excellent argument. But I thought about your arguments, Professor, and also referring to your introduction about theories and the role of theories. So I ask myself, is one theory, say, offensive realism, which is your theory, and realism of restraint, which you argue currently, maybe it's a better approach. Is it good to explain many political situations or many foreign policies of many states? I think that sometimes maybe theories like offensive realists are good in explaining policy of superpowers, like United States, China, and Russia, for example, and other theories, including liberals, are better in explaining circumstances and policies of countries of middle size like Poland. So because it is a question for us all here, what policy would be good for Poland? It is a crucial question. And how much we can be inspired by your books? My answer would be that it is very important to look at your arguments which explain American policy, but it's not enough to cover all possibilities we face in our region. So it would be my answer. Final point concerning that discussion on American policy. I've noticed a change of American policy with the Donald Trump administration. You say that it's a change of the system, of the structure of the system. But I have noticed one important element of the policy, particularly the liberal arguments in pursuing realistic goals towards China. It was alliance of freedom of religion established by the administration, which is generally freedom of religion is a liberal term. But it was, in my opinion, Poland participated in that. I myself took part in the meetings on that. But it was a good instrument to press China. So liberal instrument to achieve realist goals. So sometimes it's very difficult to divide these instruments and these categories. What is liberal, what is realistic? And I remember very well, it was Edward Carret Carr who wrote that states always pursue realistic policy, national goals, but again, always present this policy in idealistic and liberal terms. So it will be my conclusion.
Okay, I will ask Professor Mearsheimer to comment on what you said, but before that, I would like to ask Małgorzata Bonikowska, do you see, and you're an outstanding expert on EU affairs, the EU being a part of a hegemonic American project, so to say, which somewhere in its core is meant or was meant to confront Russia? Is this the way, and you do know inner EU dealings, the way the EU sees itself?
First of all, let me thank you for having me here. And let me also say that I was very happy to be able to hear Professor Mearsheimer also in Poland when you were last time and, we're having conferences here. So I hope we'll be able to have you back once, pandemic is less. I would first, before I answer your question, Vito, I would like also to comment a little bit on the book itself, because I do believe it's an important book, because I also do believe that theories can help very much in explaining what we are being into, because the reality is going so fast that the analysis of what's going on, it's not really catching up so fast to explain to us what is it. But I think it's absolutely needed to try to build some theories around it. My comment would be, first of all, I think Professor Mearsheimer mentioned that he himself remembers bipolar world. And I think many of us, especially decision makers, do remember that. So that's a very good example because it recalls our own mental maps. We easily can refresh these memories. Then we have this unipolar moment. And of course, we had this illusion, and I agree that this will be maybe forever like that. But it was this moment, really, which is over, I do agree, as well. And we have now this reality, which it's a little bit more difficult to describe this just multipolar. Because one more thing I want to add to this is there are new dimensions of international relations which didn't exist earlier. So, first of all, we are in the 21st century and we are into a technological revolution, which opens up for the political science and for international relations completely new dimensions of activities. Hybrid attacks, information war, the predominant aspect, you know, of innovations and technology role also in international relations. So I think it has to be somehow included in the theories who try to describe this reality we are living in. And this will change, I think, the system very, very deeply in the way we are not able maybe even to say yet, because that's really something new for us, these dimensions. Second thing is, I also believe that we don't have this memory, vivid memory of multipolar world. None of us. We didn't live in such world. So we cannot recall our own experiences when we try to describe the reality we're facing. So we are taking some notions from the past, from history, like the concert of powers from 19th century or some other theories to help us to describe it. But I don't believe they are really, I mean, good explanations. The same way like the pure liberalism or nationalism or realism is not good enough really to explain 21st century. I would even argue that when we think about nationalism or liberalism, I would maybe prefer today to think about openness and closeness of certain ideologies. The same way like humans, Professor, in your book, you mentioned this very clearly that we are all humans and the human aspect matters a lot in international relations as well. So we have to analyze also, you know, how much individualistic approach we mentioned, how much this community aspect we are feeling and we are bringing into. So I think here, again, this notion of openness or closeness of countries or of political systems is really, it could be a bit helpful as well, because I can imagine that we can have nationalism, which is very realistic, and we can have liberalism, which is very realistic as well. So both these ideologies, liberalism and nationalism, can be irrealistic or realistic, depends on the government and on the country. So this was my second point. And my third point, as far as the European Union is concerned, of course, well, you were referring mostly to the US, which is a country, federal state. So you're making foreign policy is different than the EU experiment. The European Union is not a state. We are 27 members. So of course, the nature, the DNA of European Union as a project is different. Of course, the European Union would not be possible without the cooperation with the US. And in this sense, we thought it was very much, you know, American-European experiment. Also, using the fact that European communities were able to, you know, were developed mainly because the Americans first wanted it, second, gave them, because Poland was out, gave the Western Europeans this possibility. Well, then this project evolved. And of course, now, maybe after almost 70 years, many Europeans hardly remember why the European Union was, or European communities were created even. But I think this experiment, this project, was started in bipolar world, somehow, in a way, being very original at that time. So the question would be how we can adapt this project, or how this project fits in this new reality of 21st century. Because maybe this is a kind of a quite decent proposal also for the relationships between the countries. Because as of now, this project was working quite well, as at least in bipolar world and in this unipolar world. Now, our challenge is to prove that it can work as well in the multipolar reality. And of course, the EU is going through horrible, maybe tensions and very difficult moment. And if we can deliver, we don't know. But if we can, then it will be maybe another distinction we can make between the countries who can cooperate on a basis of maybe liberal realism, having in sight in the DNA the principle of good governance. Because good governance and bad governance, this is the other dimension, the other dichotomic, which is now very much on the table. And of course, it poses another question to the democracies. So it means to both Europeans and the Americans, if whatever system they have is good enough for 21st century to be able to function in a better way than authoritarian regimes such as China or Russia. So where Chinese tell us, it doesn't matter if you are democratic, liberal, or whatever you name it. It's matter if you deliver, if you bring us good governance. That's a different theory we have to elaborate on. It's not so much about ideology, but it's about really delivering. It's about really giving answers to the challenges, which some of them are old, like conventional threats, like, you know, fighting pandemic, but some others are completely new, like information war, or even, you know, energy issues or climate change. So in this regard, I think whatever theory we want to build to describe what is going on now in the world, we have to take this into consideration as well. That's my initial remarks.
Okay, so now I'd like to give the floor to Bartłomiej Radziejewski. I introduced you, Bartek, by your merits, and there are plenty of them. But I also said that we are friends and we do agree on some issues, and sometimes we disagree. There is one issue on which we agree. We are both fond of realism. We agreed, for example, on Belarus. I was writing many articles that we should learn to live with mild authoritarianism. And I was fearing, and you were fearing, a revolution that it could produce a backlash and, as a result, hurt us rather than serve our interests. But isn't it so that realism is great when we use it as a tool, but might not be that great if others use it. And Professor Mersheimer is having a bit of a laugh here, but obviously some of the things he say are things that neither you nor I would be fond of. So isn't it so that realism is a school of thought which is a tool rather than a grand theory, and it's a tool which sometimes we ought to use and sometimes we ought to fight?
Thank you very much. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you very much for your presence. Thank you, John, so much for this very important book. Answering to Witold's question, of course it is. Unlike liberalism or communism, for example, realism is particularistic. not universalistic. So it will give very different results in different countries. So of course we would be happy to provide a very realistic and effective foreign policy by ourselves, and very unhappy if some adversary like Vladimir Putin will provide this against us. But this is the nature of realism. It is particularistic. But if I may, I would like to give some comments on the book. I feel that I'm in a bit of a tricky position here as being a co-publisher of this book and having mostly very good things to say about it. I may be perceived as insincere. So in my defense, two remarks. First, I publish only the books that I believe in. And the second, I promise some critical comments today. But before that, I would like to say that The Great Illusion is a fundamental book. A fundamental book that gives us a conceptual grid with which we may grapple with most important problems of international relations yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And three remarks on this. Firstly, The Great Delusion gives us the explanation of the great failure of American foreign policy after the fall of the Soviet Union. Describing the concentration as concentrating on liberal hegemony and spreading the liberal democracy around the world, it embroiled the US in a series of very costly wars and diverted its attention from the main threat, which is, of course, China, and leading to a situation in which it may be too late for Washington to contain Beijing. Secondly, some may think that this book by John Mearsheimer is a book only on the United States. And I think it is not true, as from the one side, it of course focuses on US, but from the other side, by dealing with the liberal delusions, it tells us many fundamental things about the whole West and some countries outside the West. And it also applies perfectly to Poland, in my opinion, and to the European Union also, in my opinion, which is a different story. And third remark, John describes the Americans as deeply liberal in their thinking, and it is very true, in my opinion, but it also applies to the Poles. In Poland, almost everybody defines himself as a realist. But at the same time, almost everybody repeats liberal ideas. So in fact, that's my perception, almost everybody in Poland is a political liberal. In my opinion, it is strongly related to the fact that the Polish political imagination has been very strongly, perhaps more strongly than in any other nation in the world, shaped by political romanticism. I think it's also related to a, I'm not sure how to say it in English, a zeal of a neophyte, a zeal that neophytes have, with which it has embraced the liberal ideals after the Cold War and some other factors, which is, of course, another different story. But now the promised critical comments. I have two. And the first is that I think that Professor Mearsheimer underestimates economic factors. Some time ago, Peter Navarro, who was a very important figure in Trump's administration, was publicly complaining that Xi Jinping is sending globalist billionaires to soften up Trump's administration in its struggle with China, by convincing that the new Cold War is very bad for business. And I think it is a perfect example of how the international and also American business is a very important factor containing Washington's attempts to contain China. And it is, in my opinion, absolutely cohesive with liberal theories such as economic interdependence theory. And my conclusion is the greater consideration of the economic factors would strengthen John Mearsheimer's argumentation. And my second remark is more about the offensive realism theory, which is related more to the, perhaps more to the previous book by John, The Tragedy of the Great Power Politics. But I think that's The Great Delusion is also a great offensive realism manifesto. And John Mearsheimer describes power in international relations as a sum of three elements: military power, economic power, and the size of the population. I think that strictly political factor is missing here, which sometimes makes a factor that sometimes make some great powers, great in all of these terms, with strong military force, great population, vast population, and economic power, strong or weak. This refers us to some extent to internal factors, I think, and John will probably disagree, but I am not sure that we can explain persuasively, for example, the fall of the Western Roman Empire without considering internal factors. The same about the failure of American foreign policy towards China, and the Great Delusion itself is an argument for that. So my conclusion is, the offensive realism is the best theory, in my opinion, of international relations, and it is the highest form of political realism, but yet it still may be improved a bit. Thank you.
Oh, I did learn by now that I'm not a realist, because I did prepare a series of questions and I won't have enough time to ask half of them. I do have to ask Minister Czaputowicz one question, but if you allow me, Minister, I'll start with Professor Mearsheimer and his reaction to the remarks. And just one question from me. You used strong phrases. You said failure, catastrophe, talking about U.S. foreign policy. Now, is it so? The U.S. is still the number one superpower. Now, China comes into context. As I understand, you see the U.S.-China policy as one of the proofs of the failures of the U.S. foreign policy. So my question would be, what could have the Americans done differently? We do know that there was an understanding of the threat. Proof of that being literal combat ships being built starting from the mid-90s. So it's not as if Washington was surprised by the rise of China. Washington knew and prepared. And my second question would be, you did mention Mikhail Gorbachev in the context of NATO enlargement. Now, in other words, and if I'm wrong, please correct me, you seem to be ready to accept a certain sphere of influence of Russia. Now, before we started our debate, I asked Professor Mearsheimer if I can be slightly provocative, and he agreed. So slightly provocatively putting it, would you agree with the notion that Iran has a right to have its sphere of influence? And would that include, for example, Syria? And if not, isn't it so that, again, theory is just a tool? So the floor is yours, Professor.
Thank you very much for the comments and the questions. The problem I face is I could spend 6 hours addressing all these issues, and I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to make some cursory comments about some of what I thought were the most important points. to deal with the questions that were just asked of me, the two questions, first about China and then about whether Russia has a right to a sphere of influence. The United States did not see that China was a potential threat. In fact, the United States purposely helped turn China into a great power. The United States helped China grow economically throughout the 1990s and throughout the first two decades of the 21st century. This is a remarkably foolish policy, remarkably foolish. We created a peer competitor. I wrote a recent piece in Foreign Affairs that you should read that lays out my views on this subject. This is one of the greatest strategic blunders in modern history. Just think about it. Through engagement with China, which was a liberal hegemony at work, the United States created a peer competitor. And hardly anybody in the United States saw China as a potential threat. And this includes people like Henry Kissinger and Zbigniew Brzezinski, who were fully in favor of engaging China. Remarkably foolish thinking on the part of those two gentlemen. Now, with regard to your point about whether or not Russia has a right to a sphere of influence in Eastern Europe, this gets back to Jacek's point that Ukraine is a sovereign state and it has a right to have its own foreign policy. Both of you are thinking like good old-fashioned liberals. Just think about the language that you're using, rights. I don't believe that Ukraine has a right to have its own foreign policy. Any more than as American, I believe Mexico or Canada or Cuba have the right to invite the Soviet Union or China into the Western Hemisphere. The Russians don't think that Ukraine has a right to choose any foreign policy it wants. The Russians don't think that Ukraine has a right to invite NATO up to and including it. It just, when you talk like this, you get yourself into really serious trouble. The end result of convincing the Ukrainians that they have a right to join NATO is going to lead to the destruction of Ukraine, because the Russians have made it very clear that they'll destroy Ukraine before they let it become part of Russia. Before they let it become part of NATO. So when you start telling the Ukrainians that they have a right to become part of NATO, you're leading them down the primrose path, because it's never going to happen. So I'm very uncomfortable talking about rights. I think it's a prescription for big trouble, and I don't think it's how the world works. And this gets back to another one of Jacek's points. He was saying that he wasn't sure how my theory applies to smaller powers or middle powers like Poland. He's exactly right. And I have never, to be honest, thought that one completely through. That's a subject I've thought about writing an article on. And the usual response I give is that Poland wants to think about how other great powers will act according to realist dictates. But I'm not sure what I have to say about how Poland should act, because the theory is really a theory of great power politics. Okay. But it is just important to understand that I don't think when it comes to great power politics, rights matter at all. With regard to Jacek's other point about China and how a lot of our behavior towards China does have a liberal flavor to it, I would say that although I think realism describes how great powers interact with each other, for the most part, the concept of soft power which is really about liberalism, does matter. If you look at how the United States behaved from 1945 to 1989 in terms of dealing with the rest of the world, my argument is that it can basically be described by realism. But there's no question that the United States also was a very attractive partner to many countries because it was a liberal democracy and because it purveyed what Joe Nye has famously called soft power. And soft power is sort of liberalism, right? So I would not be so foolish as to say the fact that the United States was a liberal democracy didn't matter at all for how it interacted with other countries around the world during the Cold War. It definitely mattered, right? My argument is it didn't matter very much. To come at it from a slightly different perspective, sometimes realism and liberalism point to policies that are the same. Sometimes realism and liberalism point towards different policies. And in those cases, realism triumphs over liberalism. But the important point is that sometimes liberalism complements realism. And you can have a very realist foreign policy that is augmented on the margins by liberalism. And this is another way of saying hard power can be augmented by soft power. Just to go to Malgorzata's two main points, I think you're basically saying that the 21st century is different than the 20th century or the 19th century. There's been a fundamental change, and you spent a lot of time talking about technological change. And there's no question that there's been a huge amount of technological change. And you do kind of intuitively feel that the world is different today than it was in the 20th century. But I think at root, when you look at the core elements of international politics, and I underline the word politics, because I have a theory of international politics. If you look at international politics, very little has changed. We still live in a world of nation states. We still live in a world where nationalism is the most powerful political ideology on the planet. To go to your second point about the EU, right, and what the EU's future looks like, a lot of that has to do with nationalism. Has to do with the relationship between nationalism and liberalism. If you look at what's going on in Poland today, it's really all tied up with thinking about nationalism and liberalism. Same thing is true in the United States, of course. So I think that in terms of the major political forces that shape international relations, and here I'm talking about nationalism, realism, liberalism, actually not much has changed at all. The 21st century looks a lot like the 20th century. The other point that I would make to you just on this issue, I think that the most important technological change in modern history is the coming of nuclear weapons. I think nuclear weapons had an effect on international politics that is much greater than the technological changes that are taking place now. In other words, I agree with what you're saying about this tremendous technological change we see happening in the world. I agree with you as to how fast it is happening. But the point that I'm making is I think the basic political structure has not changed that much. The international political structure has not changed that much. And again, I think nuclear weapons are the really key technological matter. With regard to the future of the EU, very simply, my argument has always been that the future of the EU is inextricably linked up with the future of NATO. The future of NATO matters because security is at the foundation of the European Union. The European Union, to succeed, requires a peaceful Europe. And a peaceful Europe can only result from an American military presence through NATO. So as long as NATO exists, as long as the United States remains in Europe, I think the EU is in reasonably good shape. If the Americans were to leave Europe and focus almost exclusively on China, and NATO were to disappear, I believe the EU would fall apart quite quickly. With regard to Bartolomiej's excellent points, he said that he thought that I underestimate economic factors. I think that there is some truth in that, in the sense that I focus on international politics. This gets back to my previous points, that, you know, I'm talking about the political structure of the world, international politics. I'm not an economist. But in my defense, I would note to you that I do believe that the foundation of military power is economic might. I do believe, if you read my article in Foreign Affairs on the rise of China, that it is absolutely essential that the United States maintain its lead over China in terms of cutting-edge technologies. So I think technological development matters enormously for power. I think it's very important that the United States be economically powerful. So I agree with your basic point that I don't feature economic factors in the theory as much as I might, but I'm trying to say that deep down in the theory is a big focus on economic considerations. And then my final point very quickly, you said that the missing factor in my discussion of power is basically domestic politics, political regime. And you talked about the Roman Empire and the fall of the Roman Empire, and you said you couldn't simply explain that without domestic politics. Two points. One, domestic politics is left on the cutting room floor in my theory. It's very important to understand that. I am simplifying reality. This gets back to the moderator's initial question to me. I am simplifying reality, and domestic politics gets left out of the story. So are there going to be certain things that I can't explain because I left that factor out? That just goes with the territory when you theorize. But the second point I would make to you is that my theory is not a good theory of change. Realism tells you very little about change. When the Soviet Union collapsed, lots of people in the United States said realism is a bankrupt policy or a bankrupt theory, excuse me. Realism is a bankrupt theory because it didn't predict the collapse of the Soviet Union. My response to that is realism doesn't explain change. It can't account for the collapse of the Soviet Union. Realism tells you all about all sorts of things about the relations among great powers, but it doesn't tell you about change inside great powers. So the truth is, I have nothing to say about the collapse of the Roman Empire or about the Soviet Union, because my theory, Ken Waltz's theory, has no theory of change embedded in it. Nevertheless, this is not to say you are wrong, because you're not wrong. You're right when you say that I neglect domestic politics. I purposely neglect domestic politics, and I understand that there is a certain danger in doing that.
Thank you, Professor. Now I'd like to ask Professor Czaputowicz, who, apart from being a renowned scholar, was also the foreign minister three questions. First, and this leads me back to your past in the communist era. Professor Mersheimer said explicitly that, well, rights do not matter at all. I hope I wrote it down correctly. Now, that would mean that in the situation we have in the Ukraine right now, we ought to contain not Russia, but we should rather contain the Ukrainians as a nation. Is it possible to contain the will of nations or regions in the long run? I mean, your life would prove that it's not possible, because when you were joining the opposition, you didn't really have a great chance of winning, right? And yet you did. You did take the risk. So people do things which are idealistic rather than realistic. And that would be my first question. Second, isn't it so that the liberal world order is built to a large degree on the fact that nations build alliances, and those alliances are to a large extent built on a similar set of values, and later that produces a result? And what I mean by that is that if we look at the US-China relations, the US power is multiplied by alliances with a whole range of nations which fear China, but which treat the United States as an ally, partly to a large extent because of a similar set of values. And last but least, if we were to look at world politics from the point of view of the superpowers, and only the superpowers, and look at it in a kind of a power politics kind of way, isn't it so that it ultimately leads us to a balance of power kind of situation? And my question is the system of balance of powers, of balancing, ultimately unstable? I mean, it is stable as long as the balancing is successful. The moment the balancing goes wrong, the system crumbles, and it crumbles dramatically. Now, we could talk First World War right now, but I just want to stop here. So, Professor Chaputov, the floor is yours.
Thank you for these important questions. But let me just try to challenge Professor Mersheimer, not from idealistic point of view. I am of an opinion that ideas matter, but from realist point of view concerning Ukraine, because we do not perceive in Poland and in this part of Europe that Ukraine, it is about idealistic ideas or rights of Ukrainians to have sovereignty. We simply, I think, perceive it as a kind of a very realistic fight between two powers, in this case, US and the West, and Russia, for sphere of influence, for power, to maximize influence. Even you can say that it's a kind of a geopolitical fight. Can you, Professor, say that it was a mistake to admit Poland, or better, Lithuania to NATO? Because Lithuanians have a right to sovereignty. No, they don't have right. Russia does not agree with that. So you see, the problem is that some people perceive that in terms of geopolitics and realist competition, US and the West was made mistakes, and maybe it was too late. Maybe we should have done it earlier. Maybe we should not sign a Nord Stream agreement to give more finances and power to Russia, and to mobilize resources and conduct very, very negative policy from the point of view of the interests of Western countries. So it would be easy to just to don't agree with you from liberal point of view, but also from realist point of view, which is predominant position in Poland. And I do not agree with the introduction to the book and Bartłomiej Radziejowski, who writes that Polish foreign policy is wrong because it's too liberal, or it is liberal. No, it is not liberal. It is a common sense, I call it common sense realism. It is a policy with the aim to pursue national interest. Let me quote one very famous quote in Poland, in Polish, but in English it would be, with all respect to Belarusians, it is a political goal for us. You know, everybody in Poland knows what I mean. So is it a liberal understanding of the policy? So, but saying that, and also with my background from opposition and from human rights activity, I think that also liberal values are very important, because not only they are important as such, but also because they are good tools in pursuing policy with, aiming at realization of national goals or egoistic goals. So it is very important to maintain that in mind. Poland was a Security Council member 2018-2019. Main priority was to strengthen international law. And it was not because international is nice, like liberals say, but it is so because we understand that strengthening international law is in our best interest. So this is, here I see the difference between middle-sized countries like Poland and superpowers that perceive world differently because we interpret our interest differently. So it is like, I think this is my explanation to the sort of question. Let me also refer to your question concerning alliances and similarities between them, the same values, and there's something in that. I understand from books the division in Athens and fight of Thucydides, alliances created by Athens and Sparta, and they were based on this second image difference, meaning on values, on democracy. And when you look at the meeting recently called by President Biden, more than 100 democratic countries, the Summit of Democracies, it is something in that, that democratic countries tend to align with themselves. I agree at the same time with the criticism of democratic peace theory by John Mearsheimer, very strong. But we can look at that also as a good instrument. Again, as an instrument in realist terms, to simply look for alliances with countries which it is easier to maintain contacts, they're again in the same alliances. They have simply similar interests, not because they are democratic, but because they are in this part of the world and they have similar challenges and maybe threat perception. So, this similarity is very important. I think I will stop here.
Thank you. Professor Mearsheimer said that he, not just he, that in every theory, there are certain things which are taken into account and certain things which are left outside. We mentioned power, military, we did talk, Bartek touched upon that, economy. But I was wondering, and this question goes to Małgorzata Bronikowska, about three issues. And could you comment on that? Isn't it so that to a large degree, mindset, or to say cultural code, is a very important factor in foreign policy? As an example, it might be said that what the West proposes Russia is a compromise, but seen as a sign of weakness by Russia, and that creates a misunderstanding. Now, the second element, isn't it so that there are psychological elements? Whenever there is talk of Russia becoming an ally of the West in its containment policy against China, I always think that there is no way Russia is psychologically able to accept a role of a junior partner of the West. And thirdly, isn't it so that sometimes the interests of the elites are not fully aligned with the interests of the nations those elites run? And Russia is a prime example. It is, of course, a huge question to what degree Russian foreign policy is based on the interests of Russia and to what degree it's the interests of the elites. It's probably both of these two elements, sometimes one taking the center stage, someone the other. So could you comment on these three elements? Because I believe that these surely do not play a central role as military power and the economy, but there's my strong belief is that they do play a role.
Well, my short answer is, of course, yes, I do believe that that's exactly the case. And that's why I stressed this human aspect. Even Professor Mecharmer mentioned in his book, I believe, you know, we are all, we operate in our own mental maps. It's not only about the nations, but it's also about the scientists, like political scientists. And I do believe in 21st century, I want to be understood well, the change is so deep that it influences very strongly the whole nature of politics. And it's very visible in the behavior of politicians, in the use of, you know, the tools, but also in the consequences of using these tools like social media, etc. So I agree, of course, that Professor Mersheimer wants to describe international relations, but I just simply believe as well that the consequence of these changes of our own human behavior will strongly interfere into the political sphere as well, in international relations as well, simply because it's all made by people. And I also strongly believe that in the century, like 21st century, which is a century of interactions and interdependencies, I think political science as the discipline has to interact with other disciplines as well. It's not only about economy, but it's also about listening, for example, to what the people who deal with new technologies every day on an everyday basis tell us. Because it's not only about business, it's about every single aspect of our life. And I very much believe that it will have a very deep impact on international relations as well. To that extent, that I think the whole system may be affected, especially when we take into consideration that in the 21st century, in the same time on the same planet, which has become smaller geographically because of the, you know, the travel conditions, which are very easy today, transportation methods, internet, we can have a look at what's happening. Even our panel, you know, we are in different places and there's no problem with that. So I believe we have to face the huge difference between authoritarian or totalitarian systems, which use the same technologies, or even they can use it much better than us, and democracies. Democracies as a proposal. And that leads me to the mental maps again and to our Western world, which by definition needs a redefinition, because it's not clear at all what we mean today by saying the West. But when we think even about the European Union, that's what I want to say, is that this was an experiment in 20th century, but in 21st century, the future of such concept, very original, difficult concept of international relations, like European Union, like, you know, integration of sovereign states on the different bases that ever happened before, it has to be tested. And I'm not so sure if the only reason for the European Union's future is NATO. Of course, NATO was the case in 20th century. Yes, I agree. But in 21st century, there are some other elements which will determine the EU's future. One of these elements is internal dynamics between these member states. And I agree here that, of course, this fight between liberalism and nationalism now it's at stake, but there are also many other elements. And the elements mentioned by Vipok, it's what the people think, how people behave, what democracy's principles and how we see the values, what Professor Chaputovich also mentioned, and many, many other elements. So the 21st century is a very difficult century, especially for democratic regimes, because they have to prove now, you know, it's not only about liberalism, it's also about the whole nature of democracy, if democracy can work as well as it worked earlier in such complex reality with people, demos, the core of democracy, who don't seem to be even ready for this reality. So we are facing just the possibility of collapse or being, you know, or that the authoritarian regime may prevail, which that I understand, you know, this intuitive, searching for mobilization of democracies proposed by President Biden. It's very realistic, actually, in the same time. It's not idealistic. It's very realistic because the danger is very much felt. And I think we are not ready. We, people who live in democracies, we are not ready to accept that some other systems or some other ideologies can rule our world. So my point, my final point is that our mental maps are kind of a trap we are into, because Professor Merheimen also mentioned 20th century and multilateral world, which suggests that despite all these changes, nothing really essential will change in international relations in 21st century. I'm not so sure about that. I think we can say so because we are ourselves in our mental maps, which limit our own understanding, especially of the new phenomena, which are new, which are very difficult for us to understand.
We're shortly running out of time, and I would like to ask Bartek Radziejewski to sum up. However, if you allow me one last question to Professor Mersheimer, one theoretical and one very practical. The theoretical question would be, you did call the US foreign policy after Cold War a failure. You surely agree that it was a success during the Cold War. Now, as I understand US foreign policy during the Cold War, to US foreign policy towards the Soviet Union, it was a mix of containment and engagement. There were both. Now, if you were to give advice to US policymakers today on China policy, as I understand, you would advocate more containment, less engagement. But however, what is the perfect mix in your opinion? And a very practical question, we have a very worrying situation on the Russian-Ukrainian border with approximately 100,000 Russian troops amassed on the border. So what is the way out to defuse this situation? Fyodor Lukyanov, editor-in-chief of Russian Global Politics, wrote an article in which he said that Finlandization is an option. The thing is that how do we understand Finlandization, and what happens if that were to be an option for Ukraine and not for Belarus? Because that would obviously mean that the situation, the military sense, would be still bad, given that the probability of Russian forces moving towards NATO borders. So what is your recipe for diffusing this situation in a very practical kind of way?
I'm going to be very quick because I want to let Bartłomiej speak. Just very quickly, I do not believe that we pursued a policy of containment plus engagement towards the Soviet Union during the Cold War. In fact, I believe we pursued an almost pure policy of containment. We tried to contain the Soviet Union, and the truth is we tried to wreck the Soviet Union. And I believe with regard to China, we will not pursue engagement anymore. We will try to pursue a pure containment policy. Our goal over the long term will be to weaken China and hopefully to make sure that China goes the way of the Soviet Union. Very important to understand that the United States is a ruthless great power and it does not tolerate peer competitors. With regard to Ukraine and how to fix that problem, I laid out my thinking on this in an article in Foreign Affairs in 2014. And the key is for NATO, and especially for the United States, to make it clear to the Russians that Ukraine is not going to become part of NATO, and then go to great lengths to neutralize Ukraine, turn it into a neutral country. Finlandization is a term that people use these days. But I think the basic thrust of that argument that people are making today about neutralizing Ukraine is correct. As long as we persist, we meaning the United States, persist in making Ukraine a part of NATO, the Russians are going to go to great lengths to try to wreck that country and prevent it from becoming part of NATO. I don't believe this is in Poland's interest. I don't believe it's in Russia's interest. I don't believe it's in the United States' interest. And I certainly do not believe it's in the Ukrainians' interest. And I blame the Americans, as I said before, for leading the Ukrainians down the primrose path. And before that, leading the Georgians down the primrose path.
Do you believe that Russia would accept such a option of neutralization, or say Finlandization of Ukraine?
Yes. My experience dealing with the Russians throughout the 2000s is they do not understand why the Americans pay zero attention to their interests. The Russians' basic view is we have no reason to have bad relations with the United States. And in fact, you, the United States, have a vested interest in having good relations with us so that the two of us can be together against China. Why are you pushing us into the arms of the Chinese? You understand that what the United States is doing today with its Russia policy is a violation of balance of power logic. We are, instead of working to make Russia an ally in a containment policy against China, we are pushing the Russians into the arms of the Chinese. This is remarkably foolish. We have no interest in picking a fight with the Russians. And if you go to Moscow, Russian elites will tell you that. Why are you picking a fight with us? It makes no sense. But the United States believes that Ukraine has a right to join NATO. And we are going to great lengths to do everything we can to make Ukraine a Western bulwark on Russia's border. And anybody who understands basic realist logic knows that that's a prescription for disaster. But then again, most Americans don't appreciate realist logic, and they continue to pursue this remarkably foolish policy.
We have to stop here, although I would say that the huge question would be if Russians accept realistic logic and would accept neutralization in what neutralization actually means. But let's stop it here because we could run another debate for another 1.5 hours. Our host, Bartłomiej Radziejewski.
Thank you very much. The summary of this debate would be an extremely difficult task for me. So I will do it very briefly at the end, if it's possible. And before that, a few comments on the previous topics. As to the Ukraine, I think that the case is at least very simple. Expansion of NATO and to Ukraine is in our interest, of course, but it will make Russians very angry, and it will make Russia provide us with a brutal Russian reaction, as John pointed out. So if to do it, it can only be do it with teeth, with power. So if the Ukraine is to join NATO, the NATO have to be ready to fight for the Ukraine and contain all the possible negative Russian reactions, including military campaign and the scenario of the destruction of Ukraine. And the question is it ready for that? And the answer is, of course, not. As to the culture, if I understand you correctly, Witold, you pointed out some another group of factors that are outside the realist theory. I think that culture matters, as Roger Scruton said. Underestimating it is one of the problems with realistic theories. But from the other side, we may turn the question around and ask, aren't cultural factors overrated in many analyses of our times? I think they are, and the factors of power, the race for power, uncertain intentions, and other things on which the political realism focuses are really the ones that are underestimated nowadays, especially in Poland. And there are, we may point out some other factors, psychological, irrational. Realistic theories, including the offensive realism, are just general frames, as John pointed it out in many occasions, including today. If something disrupts the general realistic logic, an obligation of a good realist, in my opinion, is to consider it. And this is what John Mersheimer was doing in his book, The Israeli Lobby and American Foreign Policy. And also, to some degree, he's doing that in The Great Delusion. We can go further and consider the thesis of those who claim that we live or will soon live in a new medieval times. Hedley Bull was one of them. In some recently popular movies, such as The Vikings or The Last Kingdom, despite all their weaknesses, we can see how irrational, chaotic, full of individual ambitions the medieval politics were. It was possible to even destroy the kingdom by a single intrigue or by other actions of a single person. And that means that the role of an irrational factor may be enormous. And if the diagnosis of new Middle Ages is correct, and in my opinion, is at least partly is, then we should prepare ourselves for the rise of their importance. This is also related to a phenomenon called the Revolt of the Elites by Christopher Lesch. We have very, very weak elites in the West, and they continue to weaken. And weak elites mean limited ability to do real politics. So my conclusion is I agree with the assumptions of the offensive realism, but I also agree that it has its limits, and suppose that these limits may grow in some ways in the years to come. But this will be in the circumstances of the general comeback of the dinosaurs. People like John, people like me, who claim that some rules of the international relations are simply eternal. And my conclusion, my final conclusion, is that The Great Delusion by John Mersheimer is a really brilliant book, providing us very important conceptual grid. I think it is a must read in Poland in the years to come. Thank you.
My conclusion will be much shorter and much less intellectual. And I'll just say that it was a pleasure to host and moderate a discussion between, putting it in a very simple way, clever people. So thank you very much for taking part. I'd like to thank, again, in alphabetical order, Małgorzata Bonikowska, Minister Jacek Czaputowicz, Professor John Mersheimer, and Bartłomiej Radziejewski. Thank you very much.
Thank you.